This is Covering the Spread. Here are your hosts, Jim Saunas and Dr. Ed Feng.
What is going on, everybody? Welcome on into Covering the Spread. That's right here on the FanDuel Podcast Network and numberfire.com, where today we are previewing week number 7 across the NFL with John Sheeran. He is the director of trading at FanDuel Sportsbook, talking to him about the unique challenges he has had in this COVID era, trying to set lines for the NFL and also break down how he's viewing things for this week's biggest games. My name is Jim Saunas. I am a senior writer and analyst for numberfire.com, joined here as always by Ed Feng. You can find his work over at thepowerrank.com. Ed, we are on to week number 7. How you doing today?
I'm doing great. Looking forward to another week. Hopefully another winning week. So, and then we got some movement of games. The COVID has hit again.
It's been a headache. I was so frazzled before we started recording today because they announced at 3:30 p.m. Eastern on Thursday, when we're recording, that they were going to move the Seattle-Arizona game to primetime and make that Sunday night. And my main stuff is in daily fantasy, and whenever a game has gotten moved this year because of COVID stuff, they've taken the games off the main slate. Well, I have a piece that comes out Friday morning for Daily Fantasy that breaks down the entire slate. It is currently a non-trivial number of words. I hate word counts because, like, if you hear how many words are in this thing, you're not going to read it because, like, no one has the time. Like, I wouldn't read. Like, if there are people on Twitter, this is a tangent. I don't care. But, like, there are people on Twitter who brag, hey, my piece is 40,000 words long. Come read it. I'm like, I'm not going to read that. Like, no, there's no chance I'm going to read this thing. I'll control F it and, like, search for people I want to read about. But I'm not going to read your 40,000 word essay about one game in week 7. And, like, so I'm kind of embarrassed about my word counts usually. Right. But there have been a lot of words written about this slate. And this slate fundamentally changes if Kyler Murray and Russell Wilson aren't on it. So I had spent the half an hour before we started recording sweating my nether regions off because I'm like, is this game going to get taken off the slate? Am I going to have to rewrite every freaking word that I just wrote? The podcast we did for DFS this morning, it might be totally irrelevant. So, like, we were talking to John Sheeran, we're getting ready for that, and I'm like, I'm going to lose my mind, man. It's just that's not something I wanted to deal with today.
Yeah. Well, nothing's been canceled, so I think we're all good. And yeah. Keep the fingers crossed.
See, now we're good, but my heart has not chilled out yet, Ed. I need a 4-hour buffer before I chill out because, like, I had extra coffee made. I'm a little high strung right now, and I did not need that in my life. So, thankfully, all is well.
All is well.
All the concerns are okay. And, Ed, we get to watch Russell Wilson and Kyler Murray in primetime as opposed to Derek Carr is an efficient, fine quarterback. Yeah. I'd rather watch Kyler and Russ, though.
Yeah, that's going to be fun.
So that's helpful. It's going to be a fun game, too. Hopefully, the stuff with the Raiders COVID thing gets cleared up and everyone's okay there. Apparently, Trent Brown is hanging out with the offensive line with no mask on. It's not that hard, guys. Just, like, wear a mask. Let's be smart about this.
Yeah, not going to be perfect, but it's good to take the precaution. Jim, also, it's Thursday, and there's only been one college football game to go down this weekend.
Is that a record?
Oh, yeah. There's been at least 5 every week.
Which game was it this week?
The Colorado State game is just canceled because the Mountain West has no buffer.
And oh, okay.
So
the Big Ten's still in the clear?
What?
Yeah.
Opening week. And, two teams are not playing out in the mountain.
What could go wrong? What could go wrong with no buffer? It can only go well. Yeah. But thankfully, college football is still good, as you said, which means you can go back to yesterday and check out our podcast preview with Edward Egros, breaking down week 8 of college football. We talked the SMU game, of course, because he's an adjunct professor at SMU. We also previewed Michigan versus Minnesota, which is one of the big games in the Big Ten this week. So plenty to talk about with Edward Egros. Make sure you find that by searching for Covering the Spread wherever you get your podcast. Hear what Edward had to say about those games. And also, if you like what you hear, leave us a rating and review as well. We are back to twice weekly show, so make sure you're subscribed to get notifications as we go up each and every day. As mentioned, we're going to talk to John Sheeran. You can find John on Twitter at jsheeran1981. He is the director of trading at FanDuel Sportsbook, so providing a very unique perspective when it comes to discussing all the stuff that's gone down this year. We're going to talk week 7 of the NFL. We're going to talk about totals and all the crazy stuff that's gone down there and get his perspective on this week's biggest games. And there are a lot of big ones that have had some very interesting line movement so far. So looking forward to talking to John in just a bit. But first, we got to go back to last week. We had Andy Molitor on to preview week number 6 in the NFL. Both you and Andy had good weeks. Me? Not so much.
Covering the past.
So last week here on Covering the Spread, as mentioned, we had Andy Molitor on to preview week 6 of the NFL. You can find him on the Deep Dive podcast and find Andy on Twitter at AndyMSFW. And he wanted the 49ers plus 3 in their game against the Rams. And the 49ers covered, also won that game outright, and there was some movement towards the 49ers. So good call by Andy across the board on that one. Andy had the Packers minus 1 for their game against the Bucks, and that one started off looking really good. I had plenty of Packers in my DFS lineups, was feeling good, and then the poo hit the fan real fast. They did not do much after that first quarter. The Bucks trounced them, and things got off the rails. He and I both had things on the Steelers versus the Browns. Andy had the Steelers minus 3. I had the over on 51. The Steelers romped, so Andy got the win there with the Steelers minus 3. So overall, Andy 2-1 on the week. Solid showing there. I was not as good. I lost the total because the Browns' offense totally collapsed. Baker got benched. My heart collapsed as well. It was not great. I also missed the total on the Bears and Panthers. I wanted the over at 44 points. It finished at 39. You, though, Ed, did well in that game because you had the Bears plus 1.5, and they won that game outright. So if you just muted me when I was talking, like if we can go back and just mute my audio from that week, it was a great week. Good week by Andy. Good week by you. Not so hot by me. Ed, I'm going to go tinker with the audio from last week and just omit everything that I said because you and Andy had some good insights.
Well, you know, it, you get lucky sometimes. So we're still going to listen to everything you say, Jim.
That's so unfortunate for you. I apologize in advance. But we're going to rebound this week, Ed. We're going to trust the process. We're going to dive back and get back to it here in just one second by talking to John Sheeran. But first, betting on the NFL is great. Betting on the NFL risk-free is even better. FanDuel Sportsbook is giving you a chance to bet on Week 7 of the NFL risk-free with their exclusive same-game parlays. Simply place a 3-leg or more parlay on any NFL Week 7 game and follow along as the game unfolds. If you don't win your bet, FanDuel will refund your bet up to $10 in site credit. What do you have to lose? Must be 21 plus and present in New Jersey, Pennsylvania, Illinois, Indiana, Colorado, West Virginia, or Iowa. Refund issued is a non-withdrawable site credit that expires in 7 days. Max refund is $10. Terms apply. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER. In West Virginia, visit 1-800-GAMBLER.net. In Indiana, call 1-800-9-WITH-IT. In Colorado, call 1-800-522-4700. And in Iowa, call 1-800-BETS-OFF. Let's bring in John Sheeran now. Once again, the director of trading over at FanDuel Sportsbook. Follow John on Twitter at jsheeran1981, getting his thoughts on what has been a weird and wild 2020 and also his thoughts on Week 7 in the NFL.
Covering the present.
Let's bring John Sheeran back into Covering the Spread to preview week number 7 in the NFL and just talk generally about what a weird year this has been. John, thank you for coming on and spending time with us today. How are you doing?
Great, Jim. Pleasure to be back. Enjoyed the last time, and hopefully I can share some insight this time around, I guess.
Yeah, we talked to you right at the beginning of the quarantine time. We were talking some horse racing, and at the time you were scrambling to put up different markets up at FanDuel Sportsbook, and you made it through the summer, John. You made it through the end of the hiatus for all the sports. What was that time like for you, though, where you were kind of in limbo for a couple of months there trying to find different things to offer?
Yeah, I mean, it was exactly like that. I was just so busy trying to identify product that was still running anywhere in the globe, and then trying to get the regulators to approve it, Jim, was an interesting time. I think, in fairness to most of the regulators, they understood the need for it, both from both sides, from their side, obviously from a revenue perspective, from tax, but also from the business's side, from the operator's perspective. So they were really open to it, and overall, look, it was about surviving, letting people know we were still there and relevant, and hoping sport came back sooner rather than later. And here we are, I guess, 6 months later.
Yeah, plenty of headaches in between, but you made it.
One or two.
Yeah, one or two for sure. But John, I think it's fun to have you on for today because it's good to get the other perspective when it comes to betting. And, you know, your perspective when you're actually trying to set these lines and provide these markets. And we talk about it from a betting perspective all the time, but it's been a different experience for you as well, I'm sure. So what unique challenges have you run into in trying to adjust for what really has been a lot of differences across the NFL this year?
Yeah, look, what I would say is, look, we treat COVID particularly almost like an injury news, right? So if we hear something breaking that's, you know, key or going to impact any game, we suspend it as quickly as we can, try and get the information, and then try and go back as quickly as we can, because we understand that not alone do we not have it from a bookmaking perspective, but the bettors also really don't know. So there may be a few people here and there who know what's happening and have access to that information, but overall, you know, it's a relatively fair playing ground, and as a result, I think the onus is on us to provide lines as quickly as we can, and I think we do a good, decent job of that. I think challenges, you know, hanging lines that are so vulnerable to something that's completely outside of our knowledge base or our control is difficult. We make mistakes with lines at the best of times, Jim. So doing it in this scenario, particularly like I think back to Cam Newton against the Chiefs with that Patriot offense, and they'd come off Seattle a couple of weeks before that, and we felt like that was a really good spot to try and take advantage of laying a number that was under a touchdown at that stage with the Chiefs. So we were -6, -6.5, something like that from memory, only to be downgraded to Brian Hoyer. So a lot of bettors got on the right side of that, but to be fair to them, that's a two-way street, and sometimes it goes against them. So we just try and play fair as we can, and, you know, deal with it when it's wrong.
Have you changed anything with the process of posting lines, or have you kept things pretty similar just because, like you said, it can go either way?
Yeah, I think the process stays the same. You know, we can't sit there and wonder what if. I think, you know, when we see things like the Raiders this weekend, we'll probably reduce the limits. We see that half of the O-line and the safety has gone on the COVID IR. So, you know, whether or not they're able to play is still debatable. So we'll still hang that line. We have the same information that the public have. And, you know, we'll protect ourselves from sharper bettors with limits and up them once we get confirmation of what the state of play is going to be.
Excellent. So, John, one of the most interesting stories has been the increased scoring in the NFL. How have you been dealing with totals, and how are you adjusting? Are you using the analytics, or are you kind of letting the market tell you where you should be on a game?
I think both. I think in general, when you lean as heavily as we do on priors, I guess being slow to react to small sample sizes can be a weakness, potentially also a strength when you see the overreaction in the market in general from one week to the other, and people's perception of who's good and who's bad, and whether it's an over and under narrative that keeps being driven by the media is another one that's kind of I struggle with, that kind of annoys me from time to time. Obviously, there's been a lot of talk, Ed, about the impact of officiating on the scoring rates, and, you know, I think that's, you know, a small element. I think undoubtedly there was a directive from the NFL. But I think the other contributing factors, like, you know, better decision making, I think passing on earlier downs, going for it for fourth and short from further out the field. I think all of those things are lending themselves to better decisions, more efficient scoring and offense in general. The other thing is that a lot of the scoring was driven by just a handful of teams, really. When you strip them out and look at the average scoring from the rest of the league, it actually wasn't that different. And then we also leaned a little bit on what we learned in 2011, I think, from the lockout season, where we saw this massive increase in scoring through both preseason and then the first 3 weeks of the regular season. So we always had it, I guess, in the back of our mind that it may start to normalize after 5 or 6 weeks. And yes, last week was 1 week, but I think we may start to see more more kind of regression to where we expect it to be. I think it'll be a little bit higher, but in general, I think a small bit of regression is expected.
I think I agree with basically every word you said. Yeah, I think we are going to see a little slightly higher totals. I don't know exactly where it's going to end up, but it's going to be higher than, you know, the 45.7 points per game that we had last year.
Yeah, for sure.
So let's talk about some games here, John. I think I want to start here with the game that to me is most fascinating from a movement perspective so far this week. Steelers at Titans. As of Thursday, it's Titans minus 1.5. The total here is 50.5, and this one opened as Steelers minus 1. It was then Steelers minus 2.5, but now the Titans are 1.5-point favorites. So was that because of money coming in? Is that you taking a stand on this game, John? What led to the movement in that line?
Yeah, I think this one's been all over the place. I think we actually opened it as Titans minus 1. It went to Steelers all the way to minus 2.5 as recently as Thursday. I think the guys sat down realistically, though, Jim, on Wednesday, and you know, everyone shared their view, and we landed where we did, where we are now at Tennessee minus 1, minus 1.5 or so. Personally, I'm not sure that's entirely right. I think, you know, the Titans, to my mind at least, have been, you know, in big trouble in all bar the Bills games from a win probability perspective, and maybe slightly flattered to have the record that they do. I think they're a solid football team, but I think the Steelers might actually match up pretty well against them. I think we heard from Minka Fitzpatrick for the first time with that pick six last week, and if they can kind of build on the momentum from that game on the defensive side of the ball, I think, you know, the Steelers have been pretty efficient with that kind of shorter playbook from Ben, and you know, for me, they're a better football side, and I think, you know, getting them at any sort of plus money, to me at least, seems like a little bit of value, even though the vast majority of the team here don't agree with me.
Do you have situations like that often where the team disagrees on where to put a line? And how does that get sorted out when there are those disagreements?
Yeah, look, I think it's a good debate, and I think it's one we have internally every week around, you know, who makes the best argument for why they think the line should be A, B, or C. And, you know, we've got obviously a lot of data from the guys over many years, and I think the guys with more experience and that have proven that when we take a stance against the market, that, you know, that's what we see, and how they perform is assessed, and it kind of all goes into a mixing pot, and we come out with a random answer that's sometimes right and sometimes wrong. But, you know, the hope is that we get more of them right than wrong. I think the guys do a good job of that.
Excellent. Let's move on to Seahawks at Cardinals. Seahawks are 3.5-point favorite here. The total is at 55.5. Cardinals are 4-2 on the season, but you know, only one of their wins came against a legit quarterback. How are you viewing that team versus a Seattle team that's been explosive on offense?
Yeah, I think two different perspectives on these teams from our point of view, at least. Ed, Seattle is a team that the guys were very high on, particularly after week one. We saw that fundamental change in the way that they were laid out their game plan. We saw that kind of pass first offense for the first time from Pete Carroll. And, you know, once we saw them go to New England in week two and kind of carry that forward, I think it was a good indication for us that this was a fundamental change and not scheming for week one. So we were pretty high on Seattle, made a pretty big adjustment after week two in their future price for the Super Bowl. And I think the opposite is probably the state of play with Arizona from our point of view. I think, you know, not really sure what they've achieved. They were a bit of a sexy pick at the start of the year. Everyone was talking about, you know, second year rookies in the NFL and the progress that they can make. Yes, they had, you know, more weapons to use, but I think overall Kyler's probably struggled to utilize them in the way that we might have thought that he would. Obviously his legs are incredible, he's probably one of the best moving quarterbacks we've ever seen, but outside of that, I think I've been a bit disappointed, particularly in this passing game. So we feel like they're probably overrated in the market, and when you look at their body of work, I guess bar the comeback win in week one against the Niners, you could hang question marks over a lot of it. So I think we'll definitely end up favoring the Seahawks in this game.
Do you see this one staying at 3.5, or do you think that you could potentially widen it even a bit more to account for how high you are on Seattle?
I think we're already shaded to that 3.5 anyway. I know most of the market is now 3.5, but that was a pretty big move that we made off 3, Jim, first. Yeah, I don't think we'd be opposed to going to 4 if we started to see the money come that way. I expect we'll see Seattle money, particularly off that buy. I wouldn't be surprised to see it move another tick towards Seattle.
Okay, all right. So Seattle, a team that FanDuel Sportsbook is high on after the first couple of weeks, and honestly, they have made you look pretty smart for that for sure, John. Let's move now to the Monday night game. We got the Bears at the Rams. The Rams are 6-point favorites here. The total is 44.5, and these two teams have both been a bit of a surprise so far this year. I mean, the Rams a surprise in how they performed. The Bears a surprise from a record perspective, maybe not how they performed. Which team do you view as being more legitimate long-term between these two teams?
I don't think there's any argument here, is there? I think everybody knows the Rams are a better football side and probably more legit, as you call it, than the Chicago Bears. We were pretty aggressive with this line as well. We were almost the first to jump out to six. And again, probably another one that we would not mind going another half a point or so, trying to keep ourselves ahead of the market and charge a little bit more for people betting the Rams in this spot. Not an awful lot more. They've been incredibly healthy, obviously, all year. Probably paid victim a little bit to the heavy East Coast travel schedule that they had going into the Niners game. I think that game might have flattered San Francisco a little bit as well. I thought they schemed really well, particularly in the first half until they lost Mostert. Overall, I think definitely the Rams for us. I think the Bears offense is, you know, a real question mark and a real struggle for them. Can't rush the football anymore. Montgomery, I think, had 40 yards last week. One or two big plays here and there, and outside of that, I think he can scheme very well against them. I think it'll suit the Rams, and we wouldn't be surprised to see an easy Ram win.
Yeah, and I think that this one is interesting because the Seahawks change was pretty obvious, and making a futures adjustment on them made a lot of sense. But the Rams, it's been a bit more mixed because they performed really well, but I guess maybe it's just me, but I still have questions around the defense. You know, I know they have tremendous individual playmakers, but the defense has been great. I just don't know if the overall talent is there. There's some fragility there. And the Rams offensively have relied a lot on yards after catch, a lot on the ground game. What was the reaction process for you with the Rams? How long did it take you to buy in to what they were doing initially this year? Or are you still a bit skeptical of what they've done?
I think, you know, they're ballpark where we expected them to be. The guys, in fairness to them, did call it at the start of the year, and again, we're pretty high on the Rams relative to the market. So I think, you know, for me, we're not seeing a lot that we didn't expect from the Rams. Last year seemed like it was a bit of a struggle, but if you think back to the Super Bowl the previous year, they were obviously super impressive, particularly through the regular season. Okay, they dipped a little bit as they led themselves towards that Super Bowl, but you know, I don't think overall, you know, we're seeing a lot that we didn't expect from them. Like you said, heavily leaning on play action, deep threats from Kupp. It's good to see him back to the level he was, even with those drops last week. But again, going back to this game, you know, to us, it just seems like a really dangerous spot for the Bears to try and run it up the middle. And if they can't run the ball, then you're talking about putting Aaron Donald in his face. And, you know, I'm not sure that's the best winning strategy from the Bears.
So it doesn't concern you that the Rams have only beaten teams from the worst division in football, and that kind of preseason you guys had them very middle of the pack in the NFL?
Yeah, definitely. I think it's a fair call out. I think, you know, me and you and Jim could probably put a team together capable of competing in that division. So I think it's probably one that's, you know, in certain spots will overrate the Rams, like in San Francisco, for example. And that was one where we definitely shifted our view on that game from the Rams to the Niners. That 5.5, 6-point swing, whatever it was, from the look ahead in 1 week seemed crazy to us. But this feels like a really good matchup for us. And I doubt, you know, many smart bettors will be taking the Bears looking at the matchup.
Excellent.
All righty. Any other games that pique your interest this week, John, or were super hard to set a number for in week number 7?
I guess the obvious one is probably the Jets, Jim. I mean, we've nearly gone broke laying all the minus numbers here. I don't think it matters what number we put against the Jets. Just can't seem to hang a number high enough that will attract a lot of interest. I think this week will be a really good test for it, though. You know, the potential to get Sam Darnold back. 13.5 is a very, very big number at home. The Bills probably coming off two kind of down weeks as well, even though I think they're a really good matchup against the Jets, is going to test and see, you know, if people are just blindly following in any of the minuses against the Jets. And who am I to argue? It's been 6-0 for that strategy so far. So that's probably the one that's a bit of a headache for us every week. And, you know, you guys will know it, leaning on prior so heavily, it's very hard to jump on the Jets as quickly and get them down as far as we can to where, you know, it makes sense, because, you know, you're leaning on pass, and that's a good process and strategy. Most of the time, obviously, just very difficult when you've got a really bad team like the Jets.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think those always got to be really hard for you, right? I mean, we had Miami last year that looked miserable for a while. They ended up bouncing back. Jets are in a similar position. I think, I mean, you know, NFL teams shouldn't be 10 points worse than league average. And that's exactly where I have the Jets right now. I mean, is there, I mean, this is both from, you know, the bookmaker and the better perspective. Like, do you have to just watch this team more to see if there's any kind of regression to the mean that's coming or getting better, or how do you?
I think we've been expecting that for 6 weeks, Ed.
Yeah, exactly.
Look, it's a challenge, and it's not just ratings on teams, right? It's scoring, it's changes in offense. We were lucky that we were on Seattle, otherwise you could have been undervaluing them through the first 5 weeks as well. So I think there's such a fine balance, and some of it is completely intuitive that isn't, you know, buried in numbers somewhere that you can do the analysis and pull it out and say, here's a team that are actually just way worse than what your prior will ever get you. So I think that's a real challenge, and there's a fine art to that that a lot of, you know, really heavily analytical people really struggle with, and I'm sure you know plenty of them that have had six bets, six losers on the Jets this season already.
What about you, John? Let's say you weren't in your position and you were, you know, out there and you're the generic bettor. Would 12 points be enough for you to bet the Jets, or would you be still be staying away at that number?
You know, I heard somebody say it, and it kind of sounds like a silly thing to say, but somebody said it to me, I don't know who it was, in the last couple of weeks around staying away from betting on bad teams in general.
Yeah.
And as silly as that sounds, because of course there's a number where they're going to tempt you, I don't know that it's the worst strategy in the world for exactly the reason that we just talked about. I don't know. I mean, it seems to me like 13.5 and 14 is very, very fair. I don't see it getting to 14. As we said, expecting Darnold to come back, it'll probably actually tick back towards the Jets. But I don't think I could spend your money on the Jets this year, Jim.
Well, I appreciate that, John. Thank you. I like to keep my money, so thank you. I do appreciate that. That is John Sheeran. Make sure you check him out on Twitter at jsheeran1981. He, again, is the director of trading over at FanDuel Sportsbook. John, thank you so much for swinging by for today. Hopefully, things break somehow well for you and the customer in Week 7. I don't know how to phrase that, but regardless, good luck to you in Week 7, and we appreciate the time.
Thanks, guys. Appreciate it.
Covering the future.
One big thank you once again to John Sheeran for joining us for today. Follow John on Twitter at jsheeran1981. And Ed, it was fun to listen to John talking about totals, because it sounded like verbatim a lot of the discussions we've had this year, talking about the 2011 lockout year, talking about penalties. Like,
yeah,
I mean, obviously he has to know his stuff to be in the role that he's in, but it's nice to hear people, you know, I guess validate us. I don't know, whatever. I just feel better when it sounds like we're saying smart things, hopefully.
Yeah, absolutely. And he almost said, like, kind of section for section what I talked about in the podcast this week about whether scoring will continue to increase in the will continue to surge in the NFL, or whether, you know, I mean, there's competing factors of regression versus, like, you know, underlying efficiency gains. So yeah, that's on the Football Analytics Show. And then I'm going to get a written part of it out, because it's a prediction I feel pretty strong. I feel pretty good about. So,
and the podcast version is up already?
Podcast version is up on the Football Analytics Show.
Okay, nice. We'll check that out. And I think it was a perfect week to have John on too, not just because of the totals, but also because, like, the movement in that Steelers Titans game is fascinating. And I think it was good to hear his perspective that it was, like, actually them taking a stand, because that game is, it's really interesting and hard for me to just diagnose. So I'm glad that I'm not the only one in that boat.
Absolutely. So Dr. Eric Eager came on my podcast sometime in September, and he said that Tennessee was the third best team in the AFC. And I said, not Pittsburgh? He's like, no, not Pittsburgh. And I don't necessarily agree with him. So this game is like my numbers and John Sheeran versus the markets and Dr. Eager. So I'm really looking forward to see what happens in that game.
I never want to be on a side against Dr. Eager. That, like, we talk about how scary it is to bet against Russell Wilson. I think it's equally scary to bet against Dr. Eager.
Well, and be on the other side from John Sheeran too, right?
Right, right. Like, I don't, you know, that scares the poo out of me. So good luck to your heart, Ed. we'll see how things go, but I think it's a fascinating game.
I feel pretty good about John and I side, honestly.
Yeah, I think I always get really worried about teams that are dependent on efficiency, which the Titans are, and kind of shucking regression. I don't know if that's the right use of the word shucking, but who cares? It's our podcast. But anyway, staving off regression for so long and having an impactful injury like the one to Taylor Lewan, that would scare me a lot. I know that the Steelers don't have Devin Bush, but Taylor Lewan means that the Titans are going to be starting their backup right tackle at left tackle. They're starting their backup left tackle at their third string left tackle at left tackle because their backup left tackle is already starting at right tackle because their first round pick at right tackle was on the COVID list twice and got a DUI for doing donuts at a parking lot. So they've had a weird year at tackle. I value offensive line play a lot. Yeah. Their offensive line play will not be as good as it has been previously. So that would make me very nervous. And that also contributes to my not being able to diagnose that game. So it'll be a fun one to watch. And hopefully I get to watch that one on Sunday. But let's dive into covering the future, Ed, and talk about a couple of other games. Starting off with, from a daily fantasy perspective, my favorite game on the slate, that is the Packers versus the Texans. We're going to see a lot of points in this one. What do you see standing out in this one from a betting perspective?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, we all know Aaron Rodgers has been phenomenal this year, has a 91 passing grade at PFF. The Packers offense ranks 8th in my adjusted passing success rate. And this is just significantly better than the 18th that they were last year. And it's really surprising, right? I mean, they did nothing to help the passing game in the offseason, and Devontae Adams has missed 2 games, right? So Green Bay has gone from this team that was the most overrated 13-3 team in the history of the league to, like, a legitimate Super Bowl threat, right? I'm looking around the NFC, and yeah, sure, the Saints are there, but, like, you know, who else are we really talking about? I think the Packers are in that conversation. I am keeping an eye on the Packers defense. Last year, they were 12th when I look at my adjusted passing success rate. This year, they're 23rd so far. Still a small sample size. We've seen a lot of jumps in passing success rate numbers. First of all, being Buffalo and Josh Allen dropping quite a bit from first after that wonderful performance on Monday Night Football. But Jaire Alexander's actually been playing great for the Packers. So they've dropped despite his play. So that's something I'm keeping my eye on. But I actually like the team on the other side of the ball. Houston is basically all Deshaun Watson. They're first when I look at passing success rate. He's not getting help from the running game. And their defense is terrible. But the defense isn't quite as terrible as I suspected just from watching some of their games. They're not a bottom five unit. They actually rank 24th when I look at my adjusted success rate. They've been gashed by a couple big plays, the big run by Derrick Henry for 94 yards last year. Otherwise, they probably cover that game. They probably win that game.
Yeah.
Their defense is bad, but not like bottom five type bad. When you put it all together, my number's like Green Bay still to win the game by about a point and a half. But I always like betting on Deshaun Watson at home. Getting points, and he's getting 3.5 points, and that's the game I like.
And I think that the biggest mark in your favor, outside of Deshaun Watson, who is a very big mark in your favor, is that David Bakhtiari is potentially going to miss that game for Green Bay. And outside of Aaron Rodgers, I think that Bakhtiari is a guy who is the biggest impact on that Packers offense. Like, they were fine with Devontae Adams out, which is weird, because Devontae is a very good player.
He's great.
But, he's amazing. But they were fine without him. I don't know if they'll be fine with David Bakhtiari in limbo. He didn't practice Wednesday or Thursday. He could still play. Aaron Rodgers said it sounded like they were kind of optimistic he'd play earlier in the week, so it still possibly does play. But if he can't go, I don't know if they can take advantage of that Texans rough defense. So I think that if I had to bet a side on this one, I'd lean towards the Texans. I would just be, you know, personally, I can't quite get there yet with David Bakhtiari in limbo, which stinks because, you know, you want to take advantage of the best slide you can get. And if Bakhtiari is ruled out, maybe things move towards the Texans. But I think that he is like, we shouldn't have point spreads move for non-quarterbacks that often. I think that Bakhtiari might be one of those guys where he could actually impact things a little bit.
Yeah, could be. I don't know. I like the number where it's at. So
yeah. Again, betting on Deshaun Watson, probably not a bad idea than not.
Yeah, I mean, look, it didn't work out last week, but I'm surprised. I mean, if you remember the game, like Tennessee scored very late on.
Well, the way it worked is Houston went up, or they scored to go up 7 points, and then Romeo Crennel had the decision, do you go for 2 to go up by 2 scores, or do you take the extra point and force the Titans to make a 2-point conversion? he tried to go for two to make it a two-score game, and right. I was kind of surprised that the analytics were torn on this, where it was kind of like a net zero, where like the expectation was relatively even to go for two or to kick the extra point and make it an eight-point game. I kind of assumed that the optimal move would always be to go for two to get the two-score game and effectively right. end the game, but apparently, like based on the numbers, it was potentially even favoring kicking the extra point. But I think that like you said, they would have won that game outright potentially had it not been for that. So they played well. They just had a lot of things break against them.
Well, yeah, exactly. I mean, the Titans came back down and scored very late, but his knee was down out of bounds before that second foot got in.
The AJ Brown touchdown? Yeah. I thought so too, but that's because I didn't have AJ Brown in Daily Fantasy, and I did not want that game to go to overtime. So I agreed with you just for very different reasons.
Yeah, no, for sure. And it just makes me think, there were some fans there and, how much that affected. Sure. I don't know. I thought it was, obviously I was biased.
I was too.
I had too. But I thought his knee was down out of bounds before that second foot got in. And that obviously is another, that doesn't actually win the game for them, but because they right. had another play.
Yeah, they had another play and they had overtime. So that didn't win the game, but it allowed them to win the game. And I wish it hadn't happened. We'll put it that way. So you are putting your faith in Deshaun Watson. I am putting my faith in Drew Lock. We'll see how this goes. There is some potential snow in the forecast this week in Denver. And potentially as a result, we've seen the total come down for the Chiefs Broncos. It's at 45.5 right now at FanDuel Sportsbook, but my favorite market in that game is actually for the Broncos to go over 17 points. And a big part of this is health. The Broncos seem likely to get both Noah Fant and KJ Hamler back this week. They have not had a single game this year in which they've had all three of Fant, Hamler, and Locke available outside of 13 snaps against Pittsburgh. They didn't play well initially there. But after Locke got hurt, the Broncos actually scored 21 points on the road against Pittsburgh's defense with Brett Rippon at quarterback. Now, they get Locke back, Fant is healthy again, Hamler's healthy again, and this Chiefs defense is really solid. They're actually ninth in numberFire's metrics. They're a good defense, and the Broncos' offense does not look good, but having all these pieces healthy figures to make a pretty big difference. Last week against the Patriots, the Broncos did exceed this total, and that was on the road against a better defense in Kansas City's, and now they're at home, and they will be getting really key pieces to this offense back. The snow is definitely a concern as it can impact things. We actually saw a similar situation last year where they were facing the Chiefs on the road in a snow game, and they scored just 3 points. But with wind not being a major factor as of now, I think things are getting kind of blown a bit out of proportion, maybe overreacting to what we saw in that game last year. So to me, I think taking the Broncos over 17 points feels like a borderline no-brainer. It's also could just be because I'm kind of a Drew Lock fan. He's got a bit of Josh Allen in him in the positive sense where every play is going to be not boring, whether for better or for worse. I mean, sometimes it definitely can be, but I think that the Broncos can keep this game competitive, and that's not being reflected in the market right now. So I want the Broncos over 17 points against Kansas City. And Ed, I think that this one does kind of go counter to the numbers because it's partially because I prefer numbers always, but I watched Drew Lock last week and he looked really good. I know the numbers were hideous. He was terrible, from a numbers perspective, 10 of 24 through two terrible picks, but dude is dropping some dimes and they just weren't caught. And I think the odds that they're caught now are higher with Fant and Hamler back. So kind of trust in my gut here, which doesn't always make me feel all that great, but I feel okay about it still. Any read for you on this game between the Chiefs and the Broncos?
I mean, my member numbers have Denver scoring 19.7 or 20 points. So I do not like Kansas City's defense. I know they're fourth when I look at adjusted passing success rate, but that's probably just a Josh Allen fluke because he managed to have the worst game of the season, last Monday night. I just don't think Kansas City's defense is good. They've invested that team on that offense, and they're the secondary is not particularly good. So, going against Kansas City's defense is a good thing.
Yeah, and this is the – so the, between the past 2 weeks, my bets – outside of yesterday, we're talking about the Seahawks-Cardinals game. That was riding on Russell Wilson. The past 2 weeks, my bets have ridden on Baker Mayfield, Nick Foles, Teddy Bridgewater, and Drew Lock. We're playing with fire here, and we'll see if things can get a little bit better this week. But I think the Broncos going over 17 points, a good bet at least to me. That is all that we have for today. Ed, you already mentioned you have the podcast on totals posted on the Football Analytics Show.
Yeah.
What else is going on for you there and over at the Power Rank?
So write my email newsletter. It's the best way to try a sample of my predictions. Most importantly, and then also my analysis as well. So get that at thepowerrank.com, and yeah, check out the Football Analytics Show. Trying to do some interesting new things there.
All right, perfect. And if you want to hear the totals things that Ed was talking about before, go to the Football Analytics Show and get that podcast there. Also, follow Ed on Twitter at thepowerrank and check out thepowerrank.com. I am at Jim Sonnes on Twitter, JimSanness. As mentioned, we recorded our daily fantasy podcast this morning with myself and Brandon Gadula. You can find that by searching for the numberFire Daily Fantasy Podcast feed and getting our thoughts on a very fun Week 7 slate for daily fantasy. Also, make sure you follow the FanDuel Podcast Network at FanDuel Podcast. Big thank you to both our guests this week, Edward Egross on the college side, John Sheeran on the NFL side. Follow John on Twitter at jsheeran1981. And make sure you subscribe to Covering the Spread to get all of our podcasts right as they are posted twice weekly now through the end of the season for both college and the NFL side of things. Big thank you to Calvin Theobald, our video producer, for running the video side of things here today. Thank you, Cal, as always. And thank you to everyone for tuning in both today and yesterday to get our insights here for college football and the NFL. Good luck to your bets across all the sports. We'll talk to you again next week. This has been Covering the Spread right here on the FanDuel Podcast Network.